4 years ago, a book was published that laid bare the very roots of Western civilization. It argued that the cradle of Europe, ancient Greece, had origins in Africa and the East, and that the West should recognize what it owed to Black and Eastern cultures. This spring, a second volume is being published. The book is Black Athena.
Presented to the public,
de penser, de parler libre. Et voyez que les deux sexes sont égaux, les hommes et les femmes, comme on avait
les droits. The Doric columns have no base, you can see, whereas the Ionic columns of the Erectian are more elegant with the scrolls on top.
And the best place for photographers and the best view of the city is where the flag is. You see the flag?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Let's say we came here because I was interesting in looking at this wonderful, let's say, Acropolis. I think it's part of everybody's history in some way.
Well, it's the basis of all democracy, isn't it? It started here.
It all comes back to roots, and that's where it is. And I think it's much larger than I expected it to be. But this is the root of civilization.
The Parthenon, symbol of classical Greece, is being rebuilt. As the architects and masons repair the broken stones, their aim is to preserve the image that we have of it now, bleached white and standing alone, not brightly painted and enclosed by other buildings as it was originally. But are we interested in having an accurate picture of this ancient civilization? Or have we reconstructed its past to fit our present?
I hope to give you some idea why the great age of Athens is considered to be one of the most brilliant moments in human history, and why Athens has been described as the most civilized society that has ever existed. You will see how the Greeks, and above all the Athenians, were not only great builders of marble. Athens 24 centuries ago laid the foundations on which Western civilization is built today.
Good evening and welcome to For the People. Mention the civilization of ancient Greece and most of us automatically think of science, philosophy, and mathematics. But is this image of Greece true to her real history? And more importantly, how is the image of the ancient Greeks as the creators of science and philosophy being used to bolster and perpetuate racism? We'll explore these and many other questions with Dr. Martin Gardner Bernal, author of Black Athena.
In 1987, with the publication of Black Athena, Professor Martin Bernal challenged the academic establishment.
Okay, let's take a call from South Carolina for the people. You're on the air.
Good afternoon. My question is the following.
Bernal claimed that during the last 200 years, scholars rewrote the history books, denying that ancient Greece had roots in Africa and Asia. The myth they created of a pure white, unsullied dawn of Western civilization was a result of both anti-Semitism and racism. and he argues it still influences the perception the West has of itself today.
I think that if people take Black Athena seriously, then they do have to look at our early history in a different way, because always implicit and sometimes explicit in our view of history is that democracy and science and philosophy are exclusively European possessions, and that although peoples from other continents can learn them through Europe and European culture, they are essentially at home only in Europe.
For Martin Bernal, attempting to knock Greece from the white pedestal of Western civilization is a huge undertaking. He started Volume 1 of Black Athena 12 years ago and has had to face the big guns of the academic profession.
Bernal has fallen into exactly the same trap as many of the 19th century writers did.
What happened in the 5th century happened in Greece and in Greece only.
We can't prove it either way. How can we tell?
He's attacking a target that we no longer need to worry about.
He doesn't know the evidence, and therefore he supposes that there isn't a great deal of evidence there.
And I, for one, do not think that he has provided anywhere near the amount of evidence needed to prove his case.
I don't know to what extent scholars today are still motivated by these, you know, objectionable attitudes of anti-Semitism, racism, whatever it might be. I should think very few are. That they have been in the past to some degree, no doubt, but on the whole, these are not the scholars who have been influential in our understanding of the way things actually work. I don't think it's played a part at all, frankly. Of course, there are many classicists who object to what I'm saying, and some quite emotionally. A friend of mine tried to persuade a friend of his to buy a copy of the book in Heffer's, the main bookshop here. And as he was talking about the book, the shop assistant said, "Would you mind speaking up? I hear so many people muttering as they look at that book." So that clearly there is opposition. On the other hand, there's been very little hostile criticism in print.
In 1989, the leading American classicists organization held a presidential panel at their annual conference to debate Black Athena. Articles followed from leading academics. Much to Bernal's surprise, they gave a serious and enthusiastic response to his project. The idea to hold a forum was put forward by Molly Levine.
Bernal's prediction for this book was that it would be ignored by the classics establishment. And as a classicist, I couldn't bear to believe that we were like that. If somebody had a good idea, or even a bad idea, I figured we were capable of discussing it. And partly it was to test my own profession. I wanted to see what we were really like, and if we were as bad as Bernal made us out to be.
Bernal teaches here at Cornell University in New York State. He's not a classics professor, but teaches Near Eastern studies and has taught Chinese politics. For Black Athena, he has studied archaeology, Egyptology, modern history, and linguistics, as well as classics. He's supported by his own department. But how have other colleagues at Cornell reacted to his work?
I part company with Martin Bernal on the issue of white racism is bad, black racism is tolerable, because after all, blacks have suffered so much from white racism, and historically, whites have not suffered in any proportion of the way blacks have. Racism in any form is counterproductive. It's also disgusting. I think that it's all, I say counterproductive because it's counterproductive for the black students themselves. Because what they should be getting at is an accurate and clear picture of the past. They should correct the distortions in history, but without creating a whole new distorted model. Because in the end, if their own picture of their own past is built on distortions and lies, it does them no good. It'll crumple apart at the first opposition.
So I'm saying we've got to begin to deal with the reality, and we can't expect the Bernals to do it. They've done their job by taking us to a certain level. We have to go beyond it.
I mean, the search for roots and origins is essentially an affirmation of identity. Ethnic identity, religious identity, historical identity, national identity. And that is almost always a construction. There is no such thing as a pure Greek or a pure Egyptian or a pure anything. Everything is hopelessly mixed up together. And I don't see why they couldn't remain mixed up together. I mean, it seems to me that's the reality of the world of the 90s.
Should we be actually concerned about who the Greeks were by blood, or should we be asking about how they constructed their own past? I actually think to even ask the question, who were the Greeks really? Were they black? Were they Jewish? Is to fall into a racist trap. What we've got to do is abandon altogether these myths of ethnicity, myths of ethnic origin, and we have to abandon both the myth of the Aryan origin and the myth, which he's trying to replace the Aryan model with, of the Egyptian Semitic origins of the Greeks, and ask why their ideology works how it does. What are these myths actually saying?
Whether or not his work is welcome to all classicists, Bernal intends to continue his project. The second volume of Black Athena is due out in the spring, and there are two more to follow. He firmly believes the Aryan model will crumble, but he has many academics yet to be convinced with his evidence.
There are lots of very interesting new ideas and approaches in classical studies about the place now. Some are motivated partly politically, partly by other current interests in racism, feminism, whatever it might be. They all make their contribution. They're all, most of them at any rate, a good deal less hot-headed than they might have been a generation or so ago. And they all help. But if we say to ourselves, yes, of course, we realize that each generation takes its own view of the past, or each faction in each generation will take its own view, the honest scholar ought to be able to make some sort of allowance for that. And one hopes that the common view which emerges will take allowance for that. And one can recognize, as one does, that is a feminist work, that is an anti-racist work, this is a structuralist work, this is a Marxist work, and so forth, and make due allowance. And that the single-minded who write these sort of things are making their points, no doubt, but they're not making such a major contribution to our proper understanding as they may imagine.
Well, I think that the accusation has often been leveled at me, and I'm sure it's been thought by many other people, that if I accuse other scholars of being influenced by their times and by their social backgrounds, I myself must be equally influenced by them. And I think that there's some truth in this accusation, but my defense against it would be that my version is closer to the traditional version held for the last 1800 years or more, last 2000 years. And I think that the Aryan model is more of an aberration than mine.
For having preserved part of this lost wisdom. During the Enlightenment, the Freemasons, who included the aristocracy, artists, and philosophers, used Egyptian rituals and signs in their ceremonies. The $1 bill still retains the Masonic symbol of the eye and the pyramid. In 1798, Napoleon commanded a huge scientific and cultural assessment of Egypt and tried to claim its past for France. But with the start of Egyptology and the deciphering of the hieroglyphs in 1820, the ancient civilization of Egypt fell from grace.
The decipherment of hieroglyphs was like discovering a new planet and finding that the planet didn't behave like planets that you were used to. So suddenly we could read hieroglyphs. And what we expected to find was something like Greek philosophy, or we expected to find the secrets of the universe laid out in very plain language. It didn't happen like that. The preoccupations of the Egyptians are not the ones that we would like them to have. So there was a reaction, very strongly, particularly in the English-speaking world. The Egyptians were not intellectuals. They were not philosophers. A well-known novelist has described them as merely craftsmen, not artists. That idea dies rather hard, because even when we could read the hieroglyphs, we didn't understand the preoccupations behind them. We're beginning to, but it's taken a long time. So there was a strong reaction, particularly in England, that the Egyptians were mystic, but basically a bit thick. So it rapidly becomes the world of the chattering mummy, the strange unexplained phenomenon, the weird script, everything that leads to the Hollywood idea of the Egyptology mummy film.
Now that the influence of Egypt had been eclipsed, Western scholars started to reassess the other half of the ancient model, the Phoenicians. As Europeans obsessively sought to define that which was unique and superior about themselves, there was, during the latter part of the 19th century, a rising tide of anti-Semitism. Increasingly, Bernal argues, the Phoenicians were seen as the Jews of the ancient world. They too, therefore, could not have been a part of Europe's glorious ancestor, Greece.
Classics as the basis of a gentleman's education is centuries old. But there is something new that starts in the later 18th century and continues into the 19th, and that is a kind of worship of Greece. This starts back in about the middle of the 18th century, when the earth begins to move. You get the biggest shift in taste and attitudes since the Renaissance. The feeling is a reaction against all the fuss and frippery of the Baroque. The notion is back to simplicity, back to the fountainhead. And in terms of the classical world, that means a reaction against the Romans, who are now seen as imitators and tiresome elaborators, and back to the pure simplicity of Greece. And this kind of worship of Greece passes into the 19th century.
The Romantic movement, which soon dominated European thought, was infatuated with this new ascetic vision of Greece. It enshrined their beliefs in simplicity over sophistication and feeling over reason. The Romantics cherished the notion of childhood as free from the corruptions of later life. Now they saw Greece as the pure childhood of Europe.
The idea of Romanticism became very closely linked to the idea of geographical determinism. That is, that people are formed by the landscape and climate they live in, and they get their feelings and their emotional sense of community from there. And it's also very linked to the notion that cold is good for you. That the further north you come from, or the further up the mountain you come from, the more virtuous you are. Now Greece, ancient Greece, fitted this aspect of the Romantic model very well, but it was distressingly far south and with a distressingly equable climate. And therefore, I think from the end of the 18th century, you have the desire to associate Greece, which was now an admired culture, with the north rather than with the Mediterranean. So it sort of pushes people in that direction to look for northern routes to explain the admired qualities of Greece.
By the 20th century, the modern nation-state could call on the Greek ideal to spur its troops into war. During World War I, the British adopted Athens, representing democracy, as their mascot ancient Greek city, while the Germans identified themselves with Sparta. They had picked the opposing sides of the Peloponnesian War, a war fought over 2,300 years earlier. In the 1930s, the Nazis claimed the ancient Greeks for themselves. Racially cleansed of impure Semitic or African ancestry, Greek civilization was harnessed to confirm the superiority and destiny of the Aryan race.
Allora, in questa sala è stato girato il film di Agatha Christie, Assassino sul Nilo, un classico, che sulla nave credo che ci sia, che lo potete anche sentire o vedere.
En el pasillo tenemos 12 columnas y los capiteles son de babiluforme abierto, ¿sí?
Francis 2世 の時代はですね、すごく綺麗な時代があったわけなんですけれども、それ彼の考え方はですね、もしレリーフとか...
In my readings, I came across Martin Bernal's name on Black Athena, and I found it very intriguing, very challenging, and controversial because he's challenging the myth or the old belief that the Greeks are the fathers of Western civilization, and tangible evidence saying no, they're not the fathers of Western civilization.
The Western civilization theory is not true, and that's disappointing in a sense that you lose your trust, so you don't trust anymore. You explore, you research, you learn to come to your own conclusions.
Living in America, we're brought up in the European way, and it's time we learned our own history to let us know that we do have one and something to be very proud of. And coming here, I'm very proud to be an African.
In the tomb of Rekmiri, dating from 1450 BC, wall paintings represent people of the Aegean offering tributes to the pharaoh. In Black Athena, Martin Bernal uses this, together with a wide range of other archaeological, linguistic and documentary evidence, to argue his case for substantial contact between Egypt and the Aegean in the Bronze Age. He also relies on the traditions of the classical Greeks themselves.
How it happened that the Egyptians came to the Peloponnese and what they did to make themselves kings in that part of Greece has been chronicled by other writers. I will add nothing, therefore, but proceed to mention some points which no one else has touched upon. The names of nearly all the gods came to Greece from Egypt.
The Greek historian Herodotus, often quoted as the father of history, wrote those lines 1,000 years later during the classical period. Bernal lays considerable emphasis on this ancient historical source. But Herodotus is also known as the father of lies.
Now, the difficulty with Herodotus is that other stories he gives are clearly fictional. That if he talks about the pharaoh prostituting his daughter to raise money to build a pyramid, or he talks about a magic ring that makes people invisible, you can't take those seriously. On the other hand, Herodotus usually gives his sources who told him this, and when he has contradictory versions, he gives both of those contradictory versions rather than just giving his own synthesis. And I think he was serious in this, and he should not be neglected, because everything he wrote should not be discounted, because he wrote some things that don't fit our laws of natural science.
There are, in fact, few surviving texts from the Bronze Age. So Bernal makes use of ancient myths. He maintains, while serving many different functions, myths can and often do contain historical elements. But can myths be used in this way?
People used to think that the myth of the Olympian gods, the fair, comely Olympian gods overwhelming the Titans and the giants, was actually a historical recollection of Homo sapiens taking over from Neanderthal man. Now, this is laughable to us now. In the same way, people used to think that the myths of the cycles of gold and bronze and iron and tin represented an actual folk memory of historical technological developments. Now, what Martin Bernal does is to use this historical approach to myth, which really firmly belongs in the 19th century.
Now, for Greek scholars, there was no doubt, and for Greek writers as a whole, that the Egyptian goddess known to them as Neith was the same as the Greek goddess Athena. And Neith was the goddess, a chief shrine in Lower Egypt, in Northern Egypt, was at the city of Sais.
Critics voice their strongest doubts over Bernal's approach to language and word derivations or etymologies. In the 19th century, linguists were able to trace 40 to 50% of Greek words to a language family known as Indo-European, from which most other European languages had also evolved. But Bernal is trying to account for the other missing half.
I am a language junkie. That when I see something about an obscure language, I'm tempted by it. And I was in Heffers, and I saw an etymological dictionary of Coptic. Now, this may not appeal to many people, but to my strange tastes, it was extraordinarily attractive. So I picked it out, and I started looking at Coptic words and the ancient Egyptian roots that they had. And I suddenly began to see that maybe some of the Greek words that are not explained in terms of Indo-European, I hadn't been able to find Semitic roots for, might well have Egyptian roots.
I think Martin Bernal is an enthusiast, and he has all the good sides of an enthusiast. When it comes to ancient languages, it's very easy to take a bit here, take a bit there, put them together, and come up with the conclusion you want. And from time to time, I think you can catch him out doing this. Not consciously, but that is the result he's arriving at. He wants a particular conclusion, so he tends to make the languages fit that conclusion.
I myself, as someone who is by no means a specialist in ancient languages, am not at all persuaded by most of his etymological arguments. I also think that to say that one word is like another word, sounds like it, is not really very helpful when there are other ways in which the Greeks adopted foreign names and translated them, and that is much more meaningful. For example, Phoenicians is presumably a Greek translation of Canaanite, meaning the purple people, into Greek. That means the Greeks understood this language. They did not just pick up a name the way Americans have used still Indian names for many place names. That means that they understood what this place name meant, that there was all kinds of bilingual contact. So I think etymology is one of the arguments from the past that can be discarded.
In the Aegean, 75 miles north of Crete, lies the island of Thera. A huge volcanic eruption blew the island apart in 1628 BC. Just 20 years ago, under the volcanic debris, the remains of a sophisticated Bronze Age city were uncovered. Better preserved than the Roman Pompeii, excavators believe they've only revealed 1/30th of the whole site, known as Akrotiri. Bernal believes that the population of the city had close contacts with the Egyptians.
From what I have read in this book, I can say that I suspect that the author has never visited the site, because there is no evidence of Egyptian presence here at all, neither in architecture, nor in pottery, nor in any other kinds. Of course, we have evidence of contacts of this site with the outside world, from the East Mediterranean, including Egypt, and perhaps with the West Mediterranean.
These slides come from the buried city of Akrotiri on the island of Thera, which was overwhelmed by an eruption in 1628 BC. And they're by far the earliest paintings we have from Greece of any extent, that's excluding Crete. Now here we have a section of a much longer painting of a number of boats. And there's been some argument as to what these boats represent. But what came as a surprise to the archaeologists who discovered them was the very strikingly Egyptian features to be found. Now here we have a short section of a much longer river scene that's admitted by all scholars to be Nilotic, or that's a conventional description of it. And this is because the plants, you can see the palm trees and the animals like the goose and the naturalistic animals, belong to the types found in Egypt in reality and in Egyptian painting.
I believe that these are artistic conventions which were common throughout the East Mediterranean. Who borrowed them from whom, I cannot tell. Probably the Thereans borrowed it from Egypt. But in general, the art of Thera, compared with that of Egypt and the rest of the East Mediterranean, can be considered as European, as Western art, in concept, in rendering, and so on.
The wealth and sophistication of the buildings found at Akrotiri are proof that its citizens had extensive contact with the Eastern Mediterranean. The reason for ancient Thereans to travel abroad was economics, for the island is relatively barren. Today, farmers scrape a living from wine production. Even modern tourism does not provide sufficient income to support a city anything like the size of Akrotiri. But is there evidence to suggest settlements from Egypt in the Aegean, as Bernal proposes?
I think there is very little evidence that the ancient Egyptians were a colonizing people. Certainly in the period of which Martin is speaking, the third millennium and the second millennium BC, there is no evidence for Egyptian colonies of any sort in the Aegean world. And I think to propose that there were such colonies, Professor Bernal has gone to great lengths, relying primarily on Greek myths, as well as rather strange interpretations of the archaeological and historical data in order to prove that there were such colonies.
I think the interesting thing about Bernal's contribution is he says all the time, let's get away from the 19th century, let's look at things in a way that's 20th century or 21st. And then he produces an idea that's straight out of the 19th century. He says that no civilization can really begin unless another civilization comes in, invades, and tells them how to do things. Now, Bernal's view of early Greece is that there were a lot of Greeks waiting there, not doing much. And a series of invasions come in from Egypt and the Near East and teach them how to be civilized. Now, that, if you think about it, is a really good 19th century model. You don't particularly need it. When civilizations start to develop, what they do is what you would expect them to do. They look around themselves, they look at other cultures, and they say, we can copy that. That's something which corresponds to a need in them. And they start copying.
I would argue that the historical record shows that, yes, that is true, but there are many examples when the spread of culture has taken place by conquest or by settlement, that the spread of the Latin language throughout Europe can be linked to the Roman Empire. So I think that when looking at a prehistoric culture or a historical one about the origins, about whose origins you don't know anything, I think you should keep your mind open to both possibilities.
Increasing numbers of academics, even if they do not accept direct colonization, do concede some contact between the Aegean, Phoenicia, and Egypt during the Bronze Age. But around 1180 BC, there descends a dark age which lasts for four centuries. Traditional scholars say this creates an impermeable barrier which seals off any Egyptian or Phoenician influence which might have existed from the period which saw the memorable achievements of classical Greece.
All right, the Greeks certainly learnt from Babylonians, Egyptians, all sort of people, various sciences, mathematics, whatever it might be. But it, on the whole, it isn't the sciences and the mathematics which are major parts of the Greek achievement. It's things like democracy and in art, the understanding and development of proportion and composition, the ideas of narrative, the recognition of man's role, his relationship to the gods, his relationship to each other. They didn't learn any of that from Babylonians and Egyptians, they learned that for themselves. This is the essence of Greek classical civilization, not whether you can predict an eclipse of the moon.
As much as I myself promote the idea of Near Eastern influence on Greece, what is so very different about the Greeks is what fascinates me, that they did not sacrifice children, for example. They told stories about it, Iphigenia and many other myths about this, but they themselves did not do this. In other words, they rejected certain things about the Near East. They tended to reject the idea of kingship for a long time in many city-states. They evolved a system of democracy which we still have. So in some ways what fascinates me about this relationship between Greece and the Near East, and I think it's true of everyone who studies it, is how very different the Greeks were.
On the surface, the difference between gigantic Egyptian monuments and the human scale of Greek buildings gives every appearance of totally different cultures. But Bernal argues that our image of the Greeks has been built up from only part of their legacy.
I think that Greek religion had a lot more mystery and animals and things like that mixed up in it than our view of the purely human Olympians who are in a vague way associated with Greek rationality. But I mean, Greek rationality was there, but it was a very small proportion. If one looks at the number of Greek texts or Greek things, most of it is dealing with religious, superstitious things which have nothing to do with rationality in that sense. So that Greek culture is an eclectic culture adapted to fit the Greek environment, but that Egypt was an extraordinarily important element in that mix, and it has been systematically downplayed for the last 150 years.
Originates Greek philosophy. But in that era, Greece was at war with themselves and Persia once more. Any philosopher at that time was a criminal. He'd be killed very simple. This indicates that Greece had no respect for science or intellect.
In order to understand what happened in Greece in terms of this unusual rise and unusual development, which happened so rapidly, it appears to be unique. And appears to be a miracle, but there's no miracle. The miracle was the relationship of Greece to Africa.
But we have to go beyond Bernal. See, whiteness limitates you. It limits you even when you get into something serious like this. And let's deal with that. Bernal tapped into African understanding and knowledge, the Southern Cradle understanding and knowledge, and so he was able to break out of his mold of European ethnocentrism.
But the value system of the rightness of whiteness still impacts upon him. So he cannot make a clear statement that the Africans of the Nile were African. He's still holding on to that maybe they was kind of brown and mixed. You see, and when you get into that mixture, mixed with what? If you mix anything with African, you're in trouble. You see, because African genes are dominant genes. European genes are recessive genes. So any mixture is going to move toward Africa.
You have these students looking at the Egyptians and assuming that the Egyptians were black, and then taking that thesis one step further and saying, since the Egyptians were black and the Egyptians were the progenitors of Greek civilization, so our ancestors, blacks, were the progenitors of Western civilization. And so this becomes a very kind of useful model of history to reinforce black pride, to resupply to the black student the missing past.
And then you got other pharaoh, other images. Here's brother Kepa-Ka-Ra, Senhewaset I, again of the 12th dynasty of the Middle Kingdom. Obviously looking like my brother. But here's my main man. He's got big African feet. Mentuhotep II. Now he was on the throne 2000 BC. While he was on the throne, the Greeks didn't have a pot to pee in. The ancient Hebrews weren't anywhere around or as significant. The Romans hadn't, the wolves hadn't come up to nurture Romulus and Remus. Europeans wasn't doing a damn thing. And this brother was sitting on the throne. And I guess he decided, you know, just for kicks, he wanted himself pictured as black.
I would just like to draw the attention of people that black in statuary in ancient Egypt doesn't mean black skin. It means fertile, alive, as opposed to reddish or yellowish, which is the color of the desert and the lack of fertility. So whenever you see a statue being painted black, it means that it is a hope for revival, that it is alive, not at all that it is black-skinned.
I think the ancient Egyptians would have had a fair amount of amusement out of the this debate as to whether they were black or whether they were white. The ancient Egyptians were more concerned with nationalism, with who was Egyptian and who was not Egyptian. The ancient Egyptian texts are very clear about what they thought of foreigners. They spoke of the Asiatics as being vile. Throughout their texts we read about the vile Asiatic. And we also read their opinion about the Nubians, whom they call vile also.
In the Cairo Museum, models of Nubian soldiers are painted black, in contrast to models of Egyptians who are colored a reddish brown.
I don't think that the ancient Egyptian were any different than what we are. The only thing I can tell you for a fact is that they differentiated themselves from black African, from Negroid Africa, and because in their reliefs and in the terminology, in the names and everything, they show ethnies. The Egyptian looks completely different from what is an African in the Egyptian mind. This is the only thing I can tell you. And I suppose that you can draw your own conclusions from this remark.
I don't believe that race is a very useful concept, as I say in my book. Nevertheless, I think bringing out the African nature of Egyptian civilization is important for our politics today. And this argument that I shouldn't be feeding the black racists, I don't like racism of any sort. I don't like black racism. I'm believe in the cultural creativity of mixture and of But I'm much less frightened of giving ammunition to black racists than I think orthodox classicists should be of giving ammunition to white racists, because I think white racism is a far more present and acute danger to our society today than black racism.
And I part company with Martin Bernal on the issue of white racism is bad, black racism is tolerable, because after all, blacks have suffered so much from white racism, and historically, whites have not suffered in any proportion of the way blacks have. Racism in any form is counterproductive. It's also disgusting. I think that it's all, I say counterproductive because it's counterproductive for the black students themselves. That is, what they should be getting at is an accurate and clear picture of the past. They should correct the distortions in history, but without creating a whole new distorted model. Because in the end, if their own picture of their own past is built on distortions and lies, it does them no good. It'll crumple apart at the first opposition.
So I'm saying we've got to begin to deal with the reality, and we can't expect the Bernals to do it. They've done their job by taking us to a certain level. We have to go beyond it.
I mean, the search for roots and origins is essentially an affirmation of identity, ethnic identity, religious identity, historical identity, national identity. And that is almost always a construction. There is no such thing as a pure Greek or a pure Egyptian or a pure anything. Everything is hopelessly mixed up together. And I don't see why they couldn't remain mixed up together. I mean, it seems to me that's the reality of the world of the 90s.
Should we be actually concerned about who the Greeks were by blood, or should we be asking about how they constructed their own past? I actually think to even ask the question, who were the Greeks really? Were they black? Were they Jewish? Is to fall into a racist trap. What we've got to do is abandon altogether these myths of ethnicity, myths of ethnic origin, and we have to abandon both the myth of the Aryan origin and the myth, which he's trying to replace the Aryan model with, of the Egyptian Semitic origins of the Greeks, and ask why their ideology works how it does. What are these myths actually saying?
Whether or not his work is welcome to all classicists, Bernal intends to continue his project. The second volume of Black Athena is due out in the spring, and there are two more to follow. He firmly believes the Aryan model will crumble. But he has many academics yet to be convinced with his evidence.
There are lots of very interesting new ideas and approaches in classical studies about the place now. Some are motivated partly politically, partly by other current interests in racism, feminism, whatever it might be. They all make their contribution. They're all, most of them at any rate, a good deal less hot-headed than they might have been a generation or so ago. And they all help. But if we say to ourselves, yes, of course, we realize that each generation takes its own view of the past, or each faction in each generation will take its own view, the honest scholar ought to be able to make some sort of allowance for that. And one hopes that the common view which emerges will take allowance for that, and one can recognize, as one does, that is a feminist work, that is an anti-racist work, this is a structuralist work, this is a Marxist work, and so forth, and make due allowance. And that the single-minded who write these sort of things are making their points, no doubt, but they're not making such a major contribution to our proper understanding as they may imagine.
Well, I think that the accusation has often been leveled at me, and I'm sure it's been thought by many other people, that if I accuse other scholars of being influenced by their times and by their social backgrounds, I myself must be equally influenced by them. And I think that there's some truth in this accusation, but my defense against it would be that my version is closer to the traditional version held for the last 1800 years or more, last 2000 years. And I think that the Aryan model is more of an aberration than mine.